Da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da stops. Nothing to do.
Good morning, friends. Welcome to the 9th edition of the Hindu Lit for Life. The event will begin shortly. Please take your seats and please put your mobile phones on silent mode. Please do not move around during the sessions as this may distract the speakers. We would like to remind you all that coffee, tea, and food can be bought at the stalls outside the auditorium. The Hindu Lit for Life has taken the first steps towards being a zero-waste festival in association with the Chennai Kalai Thiruvira. As a part of this endeavor, we are working to reduce the use of plastic bottles. Water will be available in bubble tops placed in strategic locations. Please fill your bottles from these bubble tops. For shopping too, do bring your own bags. For those active on social media, follow us on the Hindu Lit for Life page on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. If you're posting about the festival, please use hashtag LFL2019. There will be book signing after each session, so please do not crowd the speakers as they come get down the stage. We would like to take a minute to thank our sponsors. In association with NewsX, associate sponsors VR Mall Chennai, Fresh Food Partner ID Foods, Session Sponsor United India Insurance, Bookstore Partner Higginbotham's, Water Partner Archie Water, Wi-Fi Partner ACT, Radio Partner Fever FM, brought to you by Theme. I'd like to remind you once again, those who are active on social media, please follow us on the Hindu Lit for Life page on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. If you're posting about the festival, please use hashtag LFL2019. And there will be book signing after each session. Thank you so much. The first session will begin shortly. Good morning, friends. We start with our first session for the day. I welcome you all once again. Our first session is Beyond Indian English, A Time for Bhashas. J. Devika, Kannan Sundaram, and Vivek Shanbhag will be in conversation with Urvashi Butalia. J. Devika researches and teaches at the Center for Development Studies, Thiruvananthapuram. Kannan Sundaram is the managing director and publisher of Kalachivada, a monthly journal for culture and politics. Vivek Shanbhag, a Kannada writer, has published 5 short story collections, 3 novels, and 2 plays. Urvashi Butalia, a writer and publisher, is the co-founder of the publishing house Kali for Women. She is currently the director of Zuban. I welcome the speakers on the dais, please.
Hi, everyone. Can you hear me? I can hear myself very loudly, actually. Good morning, and thank you for being here. So this first panel, we've called it Beyond Indian English, A Time for Bhashas. We've struggled with what word to use, and bhashas is not the best choice, but we thought it was a little better than vernacular, and it was a little better than regional, but it's still problematic because it's like English is the mainstream and the bhashas are the other. So that's not where we're coming from. I'm delighted to be moderating this panel with 3 very eminent people, each of whom comes from a really different place. And I don't think we necessarily hold the same views. So Devika on my left is an academic and a translator and a writer based in Kerala. Translates into and out of Malayalam. And writes on a range of academic, feminist, sociological, cultural, political issues. It's one of the foremost very cutting-edge people in Kerala. Kannan next to her, as you've been told, is a publisher, publishes books and a magazine. And Kannan has spent several years pushing Tamil literature internationally and has begun to find some very interesting within quotes successes in the international market. And we'll speak a little about that. Vivek Shanbhag, as you also know, is a writer, author of several pieces of work, but principally very successful novel called Gachar Gochar, which has been translated into several Indian languages and several international languages and has made it to both Indian and international markets. The issue that we're going to look at is how can books travel beyond their languages? And the premise here, or the base that we start from, is that there was a time in the international market where Indian books were very much the flavor of the month. But there were a very limited conception of what Indian books were. These were mainly books, what are called general or fiction or trade books, as they're known in publishing parlance, and mostly novels, and mostly written in English. It was the rare Indian language book that actually made it into the international market. Partly, of course, the reason was that there was no funding available in India, because India itself, the Indian government or Indian literary organizations or Indian cultural organizations, are not particularly sympathetic, empathetic to pushing Indian literatures out and to subsidizing the possibility of translations and so on. But there was a time when India was sexy, but the books that you looked at were of a similar nature, and something, if one can generalize, that could culturally make that leap into the Western imagination. I'm using all those words a little bit in quotes, but translations from Indian languages rarely made it into the international market. They rarely made it between languages in India. It seems to be opening up a little bit now, a little more. That's certainly what Kannan feels. But is that actually the case? And what exactly is the situation? And if it is opening up, what has enabled this opening up? So these are the sort of issues we're going to talk about. And if indeed it is opening up, where do we go from here? How do we take it further? So I'm going to start by asking the person among us who is the most positive about this development, and that is Kannan, to tell us a little bit about his experience of why he feels so strongly that particularly the international market is opening up, and also Kannan, what is different, if anything is different, in the Indian market?
Thank you, Urvashi. Like you had mentioned, whenever there was attention on India earlier, like the flavor of the month or being felt India is sexy, all that, that was connected to probably to India being the just a founder in Frankfurt or London Book Fair, or after Arnold Roy's book gets, Booker Prize, and there's some attention. And as we know, that those attentions have been very short-lived, and nothing really came out of India being the guest of honor in Frankfurt, and not many works were translated, and the works that got translated did not find a market, and that process did not proceed beyond those initial interest. So what is happening now is not because of any of those reasons. It's not after one writer getting Nobel Prize, it's not after one event like Frankfurt. This is a general interest that has opened up over the years, which is one reason why I'm a little more positive about what is happening now. As we know that, let's take a look at some of the books that have been translated over the last few years. One book that has really made it internationally is Vivek Shanbhag's Kachar Kochar. And after that, Perumal Murugan's book has been translated and published two books in the US UK and probably in the other languages. And very recently I also managed to sell rights for a novel of Sundar Ramaswamy to Amazon Crossing. And so that I know what is happening beyond what I know on this, I had asked my friend Arunabha to tell me what else has happened in this area of Indian writing being published in the US or UK. So he has sent me a short list. Three novels of Sangeeta Bandopadhyaya and from Bangla, and Sirshendu Mukhopadhyaya from Bangla, Mazur Akhtasham, I hope I'm saying this right, from Hindi, and Uday Prakash, also from Hindi to Australia and other languages. So let's say we have, and more might be happening in Malayalam and other languages that I'm not, I don't have data at hand. So if 10 books have gone, let us say, over the last 2-3 years, I think that is very important. Probably any 10 books have not gone to published internationally in English from Indian languages in any other short period of time. And the publishing houses that publish these books are not small presses that are looking for translations in the US or UK, but rather big publishing houses, mainstream publishing houses. And I also see these books are getting nominated for some international awards. And they are also reviewed well by very important critics in major papers like, you know, in London papers or in the US like New York Times and Review and all that. And I think this attention is different, might be different from the attention that Indian languages have received earlier on.
But Kannan, in your view, if, I mean, one thing is 10 books out of an output from 20 languages, 22 languages is not a lot in an international market. It's interesting to see which languages they're being translated into. So is it only English or is it, let's say, other languages that are opening up? And what is it that, if you do see it as an opening up, what is it that you think is has made for this opening up?
So I'm not happy about this, but the way I see the international market operating is that a book gets attention only if it is first published in most cases. That is first published in UK or the US. And once it gets published there, then there is a little more interest in European languages. And that should not be that way, but unfortunately that's how it appears to be. So once it gets interest in the UK or published by a big press, you do get offers from other languages and it tends to go beyond English. It has happened to Kacha Kochan in a big way, and it is happening to Perumal Murugan. And other novels also it might happen that we'll have to wait and watch. I get your point that we are publishing in so many languages and 10 books is not at all a big number. But that's only, we can only take it very relatively. If it was not even a book per year, then 10 book is also important. So what has changed is, like I told you, that this is not something about being the flavor of the month. This might be a long-term interest. There are two things, I think. One is that I do see that there is more interest in translations. There are more companies focusing on translations in UK and US, which was not the case before. We have a major group like Amazon Crossing that is doing only translations from across the world. So that is one part, that there is a little more interest, and there is very little interest in the UK and the US for translations, especially from India, and there is a little more interest there now. And also that there is a question of representation. If they do want to buy rights, how do they do this? There is a publisher with the rights knowledge or an agent working for a writer, then the process cannot be done. So that is also, I think, is happening a little more now than before.
Okay, we'll come back to those things. I want to get Devika into this. Devika, your experience is a lot in the Indian market, translating from Malayalam and translating into Malayalam and then trying to get those books out also. What is your experience? What do you think?
I must confess that I never really thought about the international market. I really don't think about it even now when I choose books to translate. My initial interest in translation came from the fact that I realized that many great authors in Malayalam, women authors, were completely buried in historical memory in Kerala. There are, for example, the writer K. Saraswati Amma, who's definitely one of the most powerful writers of her generation, was completely forgotten after her death. So it, for me, getting these writers out of Malayalam, you know, was important in preserving, you know, their legacies somewhere. I have always thought that books traveled in different routes, not necessarily the market route. In fact, the books that I read from other languages, Indian languages, as well as from other non-English tongues outside, especially Latin American, African books, they all travel through the route of international politics. In some ways, you know, when there was a need to demand to renew the left in Kerala in the 80s, there was a huge, interest in Latin America and Africa and so on. So I just took that route. That's the route I always had in mind. And I think, and now talking about, coming to Kannan's point, I think, yes, I don't think publishers in Kerala make a sufficient effort to take these books through the market route. And even when these publications, some of these translations are highly successful in Indian English, like K.R. Meera's book, Hang Woman, I don't think it's pitched in a way that would appeal to an international readership. For example, Hang Woman was also hugely about the death penalty, the question of the death penalty, though it was heavily invested in Indian reality, very heavily invested. So, you know, an Indian reader would find it much easier to negotiate the book. But to an international audience, perhaps it should have been pitched quite differently as something to do with, really, I mean, which rose some very powerful questions to death penalty itself in an environment in which more and more states around the world are taking to the death penalty. But that didn't happen. And I think the real impediment there is really not, is actually perhaps would be the fact that many of our great books, which in the bhashas, if I may say so, kind of question the very form of the novel from very local traditions. For example, Hang Woman draws very heavily on the Sherazade, you know, storytelling tradition, which is a Mirror of Beauty, you know, Shamshir Rahman Farooqi's. I mean, you drown in the beauty. If you read that book, you feel yourself drowning in a sea of beauty. But that's not something that, but that heavily, that challenges the very form of the novel. And I don't think that would travel the market route so easily. So perhaps that's really the catch there. And I also have my misgivings about this, about being too focused on the ability to produce traveling books. Because I can see that happening in Malayalam literature. You know, you have a greater and greater number of writers trying to produce a book that will travel. So drawing upon Kerala's cosmopolitan histories and in a very hodgepodge way, very amateurish hodgepodge way, people who would have written decent books otherwise ending up producing poor, you know, really poor books.
So you made a couple of really interesting points. You talk about traveling along political routes. So I imagine the grand political issues which are of international concern, that's in India, elsewhere, for example, migration, for example, other things. If novels were based on that, perhaps in your view, those would enable the traveling out of the language. And in that sense, Vivek, your book, which has traveled into 18 plus languages and which has been widely acknowledged and feted and reviewed and awarded, I think it was Devika's view, I think, that the worldwide concern perhaps for the family is what opened up the international market to your book, and possibly also the market in Indian languages. So is that something that you would actually be in agreement with? And the other thing, which when Kannan spoke, he cited Perumal Murugan and he cited you as novel, as writers who have traveled. And Murugan's works, for example, have been around for the longest time. But it wasn't until they became mired in a controversy created by the Hindu right, so perhaps they're doing us a service, that they actually started to get much more known outside of Tamil and started to travel. So is it something like that that pushes it? Would you be in agreement that these are the broader political issues that actually take books out? For example, many international, let's say in English, with Kannan points to English being the root, many English publishers abroad find books by Indian writers a bit culturally difficult because they have too many characters. Ghachar Gochar has minimalized the characters or minimized the characters. Are any of those reasons you think, I mean, have you thought about what could be responsible for the success of your book in its travels across different languages?
First of all, I must say that any amount of translations, awards, fame, none of that helps a writer at the time of writing. Yeah, it's nice to have it, but it doesn't help, really. Having said that, I have really enjoyed getting response from different kinds of readers, different kinds of cultures and languages, which is also something that has made me think about what is this that touches people. So I look at it this way. I read a lot in translation, translated into Kannada through English and the various languages of the world. And when I think of it, I think it is something that is to do with the very core aspect of our lives. Yeah. For example, we read Russian writers who are, who wrote 200 years ago, and you can't relate to any detail that is described there. Mm-hmm. Whether it is the house or the horse carts or a variety of things, but still they move you so much, right? So there must be something which is really very core to that. And thinking about that, it is like, a writer, yesterday somebody asked me, whom do you write for? So I can only write for my Kannada readers. I can't write for anyone else. And the reason is that when you write many times, what gives you most satisfaction is when things come out and when you write without any effort. And when you say without any effort, it just happens, it just comes. So from where does it come from? Yeah, it comes from the relationship that you have with a culture, with a language, and which is very deep, which is not possible to really articulate. But you have that relationship, and which is why it is difficult to translate poetry. Even prose, but then poetry, it is impossible, because it is so well connected with that culture and the language. So coming back to my point, and what Devika said, that some of the writers are writing in, themes. I feel it is, as a writer, for me, it is, I write only for the Kannada readers. And that's the only thing I can do, not that, that's the only thing I can do. And when the novel has gone out, I have got very interesting responses from different cultures. For example, many of the readers in the US were very keen to understand what is this arranged marriage. And because it is also a very important aspect in the novel. But in India, people took it for granted. But for somebody from outside, it was a point and a perspective looking into relationships, right? So similarly, in Germany, there was the interesting points made about the family, about the woman who the protagonist, rejects. And that became something that interested people. So it is again, I want to look at it from how I was reading books from other literature and what is it that I looked at. And similarly, when readers respond, it is very interesting to see how as the book travels and it goes away from your own culture and where it was born, it slowly disconnects itself from there, and people started looking at things which were truly concerned with the core values or our lives and our angst and and whatnot. But to think that it is because of the book does not have cultural roots, or people understand it only because it is removed from the culture, is a very wrong way. Because when you translate, you really translate what is unsaid in a book. So if you really have to do it, it has to be rooted in a culture. So a writer trying to write something, thinking that there is a wide readership and the readers may not understand some of these things, is said to fail. You know, because when I say fail, I mean fail as a writer, not in the market. Right? Because it is very important, for me it is very important to engage, and the success of a book is not just success in the market. It's a different kind of a success. So that's my view.
So if I can just follow up on that point, I think you, as you're saying that for you, what's important is the integrity of the book and how you write it, why you write it. It's not necessarily the market, but the market is not an absent factor for many writers, which is legitimate. Why should it be? You need to be successful. You would like your book to be read. For you, then, what does it mean to be writing, to be translated in India? And what does it mean to be translated abroad? How is that different? You've talked a little bit about the referential part of it becoming, it's your things you don't need to explain to an Indian market, they will take for granted. But really, what does it mean in terms of just exposure? How is it different to be known outside and inside, if one can put it like that?
Yeah, it is, as I said, it was, for any writer, it is great to have many readers, right? Because that's really what you want to do. You want to touch, so as many people as you can. I don't know how to respond to this question, because I have had great time. I have really enjoyed this. And you asked me whether there was a controversy or whether it was fanned by something else. There was none. There was none for this book. It is one of the best things for this book that has happened is word of mouth. People have been, talking about the book, telling their friends, and that's how it has spread, not just here but everywhere else in the world. And it is not just that the book was published here and praised, and then it was published in the US, or it was even accepted for publication even before it was published in India. So I would say some people must have seen something in it, which is which they have liked and attracted, and I want to place a lot of stress and importance on the quality of translation, because some time back I said it is the unsaid that you really have to carry into another language. For it to happen, it is important that the language becomes completely absent. It has to be transparent. The story has to be transparent. The story has to come alive in another language. And I must say that Srinath Periru, who is my translator, has done a wonderful job in translating this book into English. And other Indian languages, at least I can say that for Tamil and Malayalam, Hindi, which I can understand, have done a great job in bringing this into other languages. Of course, I don't understand. So, and Marathi also, and Konkani. So they have done a wonderful job in taking this into other languages. And I also got some very good responses from these languages.
I think what I was trying to do was to trick you a little bit into responding to that question. Because a lot of the time, there's this general sense floating about, right, that writers want to be published abroad, but it's not that important for them to be published in terms of reputation, in terms of market within India, and also that actually the Indian translations from one Indian language to the other are sometimes much more difficult than translating from an Indian language to an international language. So I was trying to get you to come in on that. But let me put that to Kannan and see his experience.
Can I just respond to this?
Yeah, sure.
See, if you really look at the numbers, And English numbers, and if you total up the numbers in the Indian language market, the numbers in Indian language market is far superior, far higher than the numbers in English. But we have something, you know, that it's our, about our mindset, that when we feel that it is published in English, that the book is a great success. And, you know, even a great success in English, you know that you have been a publisher, and the numbers are not very high compared to the Indian language numbers. So I think there is something we need to reset our thinking and look at the Indian language market as well, if you're really looking at from the perspective of the market. And for a writer, for me, I have greatly enjoyed being translated into other Indian languages. And that gives, you know, because, see, it is one thing when I say that I get a different kind of a response, but it is another thing when you get response from your fellow writers from other Indian languages.
That's
because there is so much. Mm. You feel really good because you share so much with them. Mm. We share a common political situation. We share, you know, so many things. And then when they appreciate it, it is, I really feel very good.
So that's what I was coming to. Travel from bhasha to bhasha, one can put it like that, is as important as travel from bhasha to...
Absolutely.
To outside. I just want, Kannan, before you respond, I want to put this issue to you. So, for example, as publishers, when we have tried to sell books abroad, some of the things we've come up against, one of them is that, oh, Indian books from Indian languages have too many characters in them. And therefore, we can't get our heads around all the characters, and their names are even similar. So, Fauzia and Farida, we can't tell the difference between Fauzia and Farida and whatever. The other thing that we have come up against, so one of our most interesting and successful books was Baby Haldar's book of her autobiography as a domestic worker, which interestingly sold in many markets abroad, except the UK market, where the UK publishers came back and said, oh, we love misery memoirs, but this one is not miserable enough, because their expectations of the way misery can be written about from an Indian standpoint has to be, you know, the violence has to be gratuitous and deep and all of that. So I'm just wondering whether you, in your business of selling translations abroad, come across this.
Yeah. See, the first thing is that we don't manage to sell any books on ideas from India to the West.
That's interesting.
It's only a question of stories, memoirs, and you will never get sell a non-fiction book. That itself clearly shows that you know, that the relationship between the East and the West. Mm. So they want your story. They don't want your ideas, which they already they'll give ideas and they'll take stories. Mm. So that's a kind of relationship that is the pattern that is there. And since we had this comparison between Perumal Murugan, I just want to put a little bit in context. Is that first thing is that two of his books were translated by V. Geeta into English in 2005 and published in Chennai. And one of those books got for a translation award from Japan. I think it's called Kiriyama Award. It got nominated in 2006. And when I came to Frankfurt in 2007, I had Perumal Murugan in my catalog. And I had sold one book to Malayalam publisher. His book had come in English before the controversy. And when I had opportunity to present one writer in Oslo in 2011 or 12, I chose Perumal Murugan. And constantly I've been after publishers in Frankfurt, telling them to translate Perumal Murugan. So small things were happening there. But I think it's natural that when you hear that somebody is trying to oppress a writer's work, then you want to lend a hand to make sure the opposite happens. That's that aim of the people who are trying to put down a book does not succeed. Hmm. So a publisher would want to, you know...
You're talking about the white man syndrome.
Not necessarily, even from other Indian languages.
Other Indian languages, you've had that as well.
They had the same. So they sort of published that. And when this controversy happened, there was a profile of Perumal Murugan in New York Times. Hmm. When that happens, then it's a little bit easier to talk about him to a US press. So these things happen, and you know, they do help. But finally, that when after all this happened, the editor looking at the book does not like the book, then all this is of no use. Mm. So those things are also quite important.
Devika,
just to say, you talked about characters and this, that. Actually, the reason why, this is my first book translated into English. And the reason why I picked this up is, first of all, it is not my recent work. The only reason which I picked it up is because it was the shortest of all my books. So I don't think there was any consideration, whether character or theme or anything, at the time of translation.
No, you know, I think as a publisher, and I think Kannan would also come in on this, what we find works in the travel of books into other languages, whether Indian or international, is of course the content first of all, but then other things, like for example, the length of a book is very important. Because the longer the book, the more money you spend on the translation, and that means the more investment the publisher has to make. So if they get a short, pithy book, that becomes much easier. So I think it's just as well to be aware of those, and also aware of the cultural biases that, say, going into an international market, you will confront. Because when you're trying to sell a book, you have to not only go with the content, but try to convince them that content, if it doesn't fit in with kind of content they are used to, is important. So that is the reason I was saying it. But let me get Devika in on this. And Devika, also this point of Kannan's about ideas not traveling, but stories traveling. Can you come back on those? And also because you are translating ideas into Malayalam and out of. So is the Indian market different?
Yeah, I think he made a really important point, and that's what I was trying to say earlier, because many of the books in Indian languages which have been translated, which are classics in Indian languages, which have been translated, they don't really travel precisely because they're ideas. The ideas about the novel itself, you know, saying that the novel can be then perhaps written in a different way. It's an idea about the novel also. So that gets picked up at best by the academic circuit. So I remember when we were trying to think about a translation of K.R. Meera's Hangwoman, I tried telling Meera that, look, you have actually broken the form. You know, you've broken new ground in the form of the novel. So maybe you should take the academic route if you need to highlight that. And I know that for certain that even when we finished the translation, the publisher would not want a proper academic introduction at all, you know. And I was told by our editor, who was of course an excellent, very supportive editor, that it should look like an English book, you know. So that was it. So I couldn't agree more with you, you know, that ideas don't travel, even in literature. But I also think the problem is that we are in some ways, all of us, and I don't want to be singling out one group over the other, we are all somehow stuck in a kind of presentism, and a kind of presentism that does not allow us to genuinely travel, not only in space, but also in time. In time, I know our young students here probably know that even better than me, because you know we judge people. You know, we go. I've heard several students who say that I don't want to read an 18th century novel writer. Oh, it's full of caste and it's full of gender. Of course, it is full of caste and gender because you're going back to that time, right? And you can't even the best writer. Like I have seen, I've heard this response from so many young people reading, say, that an early feminist in Malayalam, you know, Lilithambika Andarajanam, full of problems. Yeah, yes, of course. But those are the times, and you don't have to project, you know, that. You can't be ethnocentric in time or in space in some ways. So that's a huge impediment, I think, in traveling in time. But in traveling in space, I think we are also stuck now with a set of global themes, cover a certain globally experienced reality, challenges, set of challenges. So what I thought is beautiful about the popularity about your book is that the family is being is under stress everywhere in the world in different ways. In different ways. But people reading your book are somehow able to connect to a completely different form of the family in crisis somewhere. Not because they want family back and so on, but it's a question that is constantly following us globally, in different parts of the world, different forms of family, different forms of living together. I mean, the whole question is whether, do we want to live together as kin, as blood kin, or do we want new forms of family that do not necessarily ask for blood kinship of, you know, according to blood, shared blood, ties of blood. So I think that must have, you know, really struck people somewhere. And you can see that in, of course, that's a very profound theme, I think, and I'm so glad we have a book like that. But you can also see that in lesser ways, like recently in Malayalam, there's a book called Jasmine Days. I mean, the translation title is called Jasmine Days. And you can also see that if you look at the translation and the original, the translation is, I don't want to call it superior, but the translation definitely makes the book much more of interest to someone who's located outside, you know, outside Kerala. And because, of course, it's about the Arab revolutions and the experience of Arab revolution by among people in the Gulf. Malayalis don't appear centrally in the book, only peripherally. But you can actually see how the translator who has another experience, you know, she's from the US and she's an NRI Malayali. And that, her touch is so very important. It makes the book accessible to a great, very large audience. So I think these things matter.
So what I'm hearing the three of you say, because I think if we get some last comments and then we'll open it up, but just in general what I'm hearing you say is that there is now, for what various reasons, a foot in the door for books from the bhashas to travel to certainly the international market, that books in the bhashas have traveled between Indian languages. But that is a much more difficult thing. We haven't talked enough about that, but that is a much more difficult thing. However, it is still happening, as for example, with your book, with Perumal's book, with some other books. But that much more needs to be done to make this a bigger phenomenon. That certain kinds of things are traveling, not others. And also the point that Devika made earlier, which is that because of the assumption that certain so-called international histories are traveling, histories that people can relate with, like when she spoke of the history of migration and so on and so forth, that writers in seeking an international market are inserting those histories often in not very clever ways into their writing, which is one of the, what one might call the backlash or whatever word you give to it. But that it is an interesting moment from which we can actually move into a future where more work can travel outside. I don't know if I'm summing you up in, or taking all those very diverse thoughts in into a framework that seems to make sense, but is there anything that you would like to say in response to this summing up before we open it up to questions?
Yeah, so since we are talking about various reasons a book is picked up for the thing. One very important aspect is that I have found that it's very, very difficult to sell a modern classic from Indian languages to the any world languages. So the moment you say the writer is no more, they won't even read it. And the age of the writer is very important. And so is it, if it's in from 30 to 50, they'll be more interested and they would want to know the first book they publish, they see it as investing on a writer. And so they'll ask you, can we travel with the writer? In the sense that, will he write more novels? And you know, if he publishes this book, will we get to look at another 5-6 novels by the writer in the next 10-15 years? And so for that reason, I think, you know, I was very happy when I managed to sell the story of a tamarind tree to Amazon Crossing, because that story, that had nothing working for it except the story itself. The writer won't travel, the writer won't be available for reading, and none of that was there. Not very highly valued in India. I couldn't show any big reviews in favor of the book. Just by the reading the book and writing, liking the story, that book was picked up. And you know, I think you know that happened. I also felt because I had already made a small breakthrough with Perumal Murugan, and that got some attention on me. So this is how these things work. You know, you make one step and then you make another small step, and I think that's how the travel is going to be. It's never going to happen probably in a leap. And if you can get the government support to bring more Indian language publishers, agents, to be able to come to Frankfurt or London to, you know, pitch these books, and if there is some grant following up for translations, I think the pace might, you know, increase. Without that, it will go to be very slow pace.
That is not a hope I think you can hold out much for, and that may not even be such a great idea. Devika?
Yeah, I must. I'm sorry. I, you know, one would feel so. In Kerala, we did make a small effort. There is a Malayalam university in Kerala, Malayala Sarvakalashala, and we had a translation project, which we tried very, very hard to do precisely this, to go to Frankfurt to. Well, it was cut down by university bureaucracy, on the silliest possible reasons, it was closed down. So, you know, these are not things that are a university that is supposedly for Malayalam. That's, if that can't do it, then who else, you can't expect any commercial publisher. But that said, I must say that now, of course, getting to readers, I mean, I'm not saying that publishers are, the publishers are, of course, the major channel through which you get your books to readers. But whenever you challenge form, and I have in my writing, in academic writing, I have challenged the form of academic writing quite a few times and found it hard to find a publisher who would want to bear the expense. I have done it on my own, and the internet offers those kinds of possibilities. And like now, nearly 7-8 years down the line, yeah, I have had mainstream publishers coming after me for the book. And you remember, you were supposed to publish a translation of that book, Kulastri. And I think it's important for us to keep the world posted about the kind of ideas that we generate in our cultures. And so I insist on translating books that challenge the form, and not just tell stories, and put them up somewhere for someone to read.
I feel we should, we are giving undue importance to the books that get published out of India. I think it is very important that we look at our own literature in various other Indian languages and focus more on getting translations across Indian languages and also into English, because English is something that you know, that reaches a large number of people within India. I feel that if it happens, if there is some book gets published outside India, well and good. But I think we should stop giving undue importance and discuss so much about this.
Yeah, well, I was trying to pull you all into discussing some Indian language translations as well. Anyway, I'm glad you've made that point. Let's open it up. We've got about 10 minutes. Can I see how many questions? God, there's a lot of questions. Okay, we'll just, you know, there are five of you. We'll take all five questions and then I'll ask the panel to respond. Can you be brief, please?
Very brief.
Can we start with the lady, sir, please? And then we just pass
I'll be as brief as possible. In this day of itinerant living across back and forth oceans and multiculturalism, it is imperative that translations are very important. But at the same time, I'm very puzzled that Kalki's novels, for instance, people say that when you translate, you cannot understand the multiple textured richness of Indian history. And how good a translation is it? For instance, it was mentioned the translation was better than the book. But very often, the nuances of a culture is lost. My second point is, when I saw the term bhasha, I was really wondering how English has been usurped in local languages, and it has become a word in the Tamil contemporary lexicon. And do you have any comment on it?
Okay, can you pass the mic here? Thank you. It's okay, we're coming to you. I'm coming from here to you, sorry.
Madam, now these films by...
Please hold the mic closer.
Now, films by top Tamil actors, on the day of the release, is released in Telugu, in Hindi, it is released in Europe, it is released in America. Why can't the top writers' books also released on the same day in important Tamil languages and English? When the new trend is there in the cinema field, the same day they release in Telugu, they release in Hindi, and it released in US and Europe.
Okay.
They earn lot of money. Okay. Why can't this trend be followed by you?
All right. Can you pass the mic?
I'd like to know if there's an institute that lords over the quality of translation, because I've often heard that the quality is not good enough.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Yes, madam. My question is that do you take the marketing potential into account when you are translating or sending the book abroad? We have all kind of ideologies to some extent, and we have non-controversial writers like R.K. Narayan. Books are very popular. So do you think that kind of a thing is popular, or controversial themes are more taken into account, like Perumal Murugan, which is a controversy?
Okay, thank you. There was other question, right?
I have one more question,
yeah.
Ma'am.
Yeah.
To Devika, ma'am. Ma'am, compared to MT and Madhavikuti, they are using their own local metaphor and myth, like Tharavar and like temple, Bhagavadi, or something like local metaphor. So how can the national readers, those who are from not come from the Kerala, how they identify this local metaphor and this local myth? They have some problem.
Okay. And can you just give it to the lady behind you? Yeah.
My question is, I'm an author myself, and I write in a lighter vein, satire and humor, all in English. But so far, I've not found anyone who would translate into any Indian language, because my books are humorous. I want an answer for that, please.
Okay, so now over to you. If you can respond to whichever of the questions very quickly. We've got about 5 minutes.
Let me start with the last question. I think humor is something that is so much embedded into the language and culture. Probably that is, like, for example, Pula Deshpande is a very great Marathi writer. When you translate him into Kannada or other Indian languages, it is, you can't get the same thing. It's like translating poetry, right? So that could be the reason.
Kannan?
My question is, from English to any Indian language.
That holds good to any language. I gave an example of Marathi just because, you know. So it holds good with any language. The humor is very difficult to translate.
Kannan, you want to come in on anything? No? Devika?
I have one question.
Yeah, it's about nuances. I mean, I'm going to take those two questions together first. A nuance is lost in translation, and the question about quality. There are no rules of quality, cost cast in stone or steel or whatever. But what it matters really is whether you can translate as you rightly said, the unsaid, what is perhaps the effect of the work should be translated. It's easy to translate the literal meaning, you know, and it falls flat. What you really need to translate is the affect, the potential for affect that a book has. And that is definitely possible. And I am really, you know, I mean, I as a translator, I would only say that if a translator has, if you don't find a book as stunning as the original, it's just the translator has not done enough work. And that's all I can say. Because there are matching codes. Even if there are no identical codes across languages, there are matching codes. You have to look carefully enough to find them. Like, you know, ma'am, in an instance of translating humor, in Malayalam, very often humor uses a lot of local dialect, you know. So, for example, in the eastern parts of Kerala, in southeastern parts, in the area called Pala, there's a very particular way of speaking Malayalam. But they also speak English in a similar way, you know. So the Malayalam actually sounds like English, and English sounds like Malayalam. So when you have to translate humor specifically focused on that area, you basically draw those codes out. You basically use that Pala English instead of Pala Malayalam, and vice versa. It can work, but you have to look very carefully. But local metaphors, etc., you know what? Why do you read translation? You read translation to travel in time or in space. So if the translator has to prepare the reader, and again, that's the job of the translator to
smoothen your travel, it's very difficult. Obviously, translation is the most difficult art ever. So nobody should start doing any translation thinking that it's easy. It's
so,
not.
So first study the local history of that particular...
No, not only that. You have to learn the art of easing the reader okay. into another world without a hitch.
Okay, okay.
Can I say something?
Yeah. Okay, yeah. One last comment.
I just want to say that for translations, it's my belief that the translator must be very good in the target language. That the target language must be the first language of the writer, of the translator. Because it makes so much of a difference. And I made a comment on the relationship with the language. So it is very important that the writer, the translator has that relationship with the target language. Even if she doesn't understand the original language, it's fine. You know, when I say I don't understand meaning, you know, if she's not proficient with that language, it doesn't really matter. Because that is how the great translators have been working all over the world. And when you look at good translations, this is one thing which is common across.
I think, you know, we started this panel basically with a question, which is what is it that enables or what has changed in recent times that has at least allowed some books from the Indian languages to travel into the international market and also to travel more between Indian languages. And that from what the panelists have said, that is not only translation. There are a whole range of other circumstances surrounding the possibility of translation that make this journey a little bit easier. And those have to do with markets, and those have to do with exposure, and those have to do with a whole range of other things. Unfortunately, every discussion about the travel of books outside their languages ends up being a discussion on translation. And that's really not... and ends up being a discussion on the faithfulness of translation and the referencing things people do. That's really not what we started to talk about. But anyway, the issue that's most important has we've discussed to some extent. I think we're going to have to close it because we've run out of time. So if you have any questions left over, please just talk to the people, the panelists outside. I just want to thank all of you and thank the panelists as well.
Thank you. Just for a second. I would like to register my thanks to Kannan Sundaram, who originally proposed this idea to us. And special thanks to Vivek and Urvashi, who altered their stressful schedule, travel schedules, to be together today with the session. And thank you, Devika and Kannan, for enriching us.